Back with our panel. Joining us this hour, senior political analyst David Gergen, also Elizabeth Foley, professor of constitutional law at Florida International University, also Harvard's professor Dershowitz is with us, as well as Lauren Coates and Paige Pate. Professor Dershowitz, I want to get your reaction to what Attorney General Ferguson said, that he's in this for the long haul and is going to take it to the Supreme Court if necessary. I mean, do you have any doubt this is going all the way to the Supreme Court?
I think it probably will go to the Supreme Court, and I think what will happen is he will win the first round, because I don't think the Ninth Circuit will undo the injunction, because that would cause chaos, especially if they think maybe they would have to then renew the ban later. So I think he's going to win the first round. And I think on the second round, he'll have a partial victory and a partial loss. That is, they'll rule that some of the executive agreement is constitutional, some of it's unconstitutional, and then he'll have to make a decision whether to accept half a loaf or whether to try to appeal to the Supreme Court, where you get an uncertain result because you have the 4-4 split.
Professor Foley, do you agree with Professor Dershowitz on how that may play out? And what would that split look like of getting half a loaf?
Well, I mean, frankly, if the Ninth Circuit is going to abide by existing precedent, they probably should. I don't know if they will, but they certainly should kick Washington's lawsuit out on the issue of standing, because the state of Washington doesn't have the kind of concrete, particularized injury that we normally demand in cases like this. But having said that, if the Ninth Circuit plays politics with this case rather than going with existing precedent, then we can expect an affirmance of the TRO, which means that the Trump administration then would have an interesting strategic decision whether or not to file an emergency stay petition with the U.S. Supreme Court and get immediate review, or go back to Judge Robart and go ahead and litigate this thing on the merits.
But Professor, the state of Washington says that they have standing because they represent state universities in Washington, which are adversely affected by this travel order.
Yeah, I mean, that's completely speculative. That kind of allegation of injury without any facts to back it up, any concrete particularized injury, has never sufficed before. And I will say that realize that a state like Washington or any other state does not have the power to adjudicate the rights of its citizens, including the faculty and the staff. If those individuals believe they have been harmed by the president's executive order, they're supposed to bring their own lawsuits. The only thing that a state would have standing to litigate would be what are called sovereign harms, which the state of Texas, for example, in the litigation involving the President Obama's DAPA and DACA immigration orders, satisfied by showing fiscal harm by the issuance of driver's licenses. But I haven't seen any allegations of facts of fiscal harm that the state of Washington has proffered here, and they have the burden of proof on standing.
Paige, do you agree with that, that the state of Washington doesn't have real standing?
No, but I do think that's going to be the big issue. In fact, I expect almost the entire hour of oral argument to be focused on the standing issue. There are two ways a state can have standing, and one is you can show a direct harm to the state, an economic interest, and that's what happened in the DAPA case. Texas was able to show that we're going to have to spend money for driver's licenses. Allowing these folks to stay in the country is going to cost us money, so we're harmed by it, so we get to sue. And the Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals accepted that, and that's why they were able to deal with that case. But there's another argument that was made in that case but never ruled on, and it was what Mr. Ferguson was alluding to earlier. We're representing people in our states. We're representing institutions in our states. And who else is going to argue for them? Because the only other alternative is you're going to have a bunch of individual lawsuits in district courts across the country, and absolutely no uniformity on this very important issue.
But that won't apply to the person who's outside the country, the Yemenite family who has never been in the country. What interest does Washington State have in whether or not a family from Yemen gets a tourist visa or not? So they actually need to have double standing. They need to show that they represent people in the state, but also that the people that they represent have themselves standing, and the Yemenite family doesn't. That's why I think even if they survive standing, the government will prevail on the issue of people outside. And that's why the government, in its brief, essentially looked for a compromise, saying we'd be maybe willing to accept a half injunction as long as it doesn't apply to people outside the country. Yeah. But Ferguson said, no, I'm not buying that. No half loaf here.
Right.